The U.S. just broke its 7-day average of new coronavirus cases as the new Omicron variant accounts for nearly 60% of cases in the U.S. now, according to the CDC. Joining us now is the CDC Director, Dr. Rochelle Walensky. Dr. Walensky, thank you for being here with us this morning. And I want to start with the change in the CDC guidance that cuts the isolation period in half if you're asymptomatic. So how did the CDC settle on 5 days for everyone?
Good morning, Caitlin. Thanks for having me. So we looked at several areas of science here. First, the science of how much transmission happens in the period of time after you're infected. We know that the most amount of transmission occurs in those 1 to 2 days before you develop symptoms, those 2 to 3 days after you develop symptoms. And if you map that out, those 5 days account for somewhere between 85 to 90% of all transmission that occurs. So we really wanted to make sure that during those first 5 days, you were spent in isolation. That's when most of it occurs. And then there is, of course, this tail end, a period of time in those last 5 days, which we're asking you to mask. But the other things that we were looking at is the epidemiology here. We are seeing and expecting even more cases of this Omicron variant. Many of those cases are mildly symptomatic, if not asymptomatic, and especially among those who are vaccinated and unvaccinated. And then finally, the behavioral science. What will people actually do when people need to get back to work? What is it that they will actually do? And if we can get them to isolate, we do want to make sure that they're isolating in those first 5 days when they're maximally infectious.
So from what you're saying, it sounds like this decision had just as much to do with business as it did with the science.
Well, so it really had a lot to do with what we thought people would be able to tolerate. We have seen relatively low rates of isolation for all of this pandemic. Some science has demonstrated less than a third of people are isolating when they need to. And so we really want to make sure that we had guidance in this moment where we were going to have a lot of disease that could be adhered to, that people were willing to adhere to, and that spoke specifically to when people were maximally infectious. So it really spoke to both behaviors as well as what people were able to do.
Well, so then I guess the question, if this is based on science that you already had at the CDC, why didn't you make this change sooner than this week?
Well, so our guidance was conservative before. It has said 10 days of isolation. But in the context of the fact that we were going to have so many more cases, many of those would be asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. People would feel well enough to be at work. They would not necessarily tolerate being home, and that they may not comply with being home. This was the moment that we needed to make that decision and those changes.
The UK has also shortened its period of isolation to 7 days, but with a negative test on day 6 and day 7, a negative rapid test. Why didn't the CDC recommend taking a rapid test after those 5 days?
Yeah, really important question. So we do, just to be clear, recommend having a rapid test during your period of quarantine after you've been exposed. But we opted not
for
to
isolation.
Have that rapid test. For isolation, exactly. We opted not to have the rapid test for isolation because we actually don't know how our rapid tests perform and how well they predict whether you're transmissible during the end of disease. The FDA has not authorized them for that use. We don't know how they perform. So what we said was, well, if you got a rapid test at 5 days and it was negative, we weren't convinced that you weren't still transmissible. We didn't want to leave a false sense of security. We still wanted you to wear the mask. And if it was positive, we still know the maximum amount of transmission was behind you. We still wanted you to wear a mask. And given that we were not going to change our recommendations based on the result of that rapid test, we opted not to include it.
So if that's the case, then why, when a few days ago when the CDC changed its guidance for healthcare workers when it comes to isolating, they said if you were asymptomatic, you could go back to work after 7 days with a negative test. So why would healthcare workers just a few days ago need a negative test, but now everyone doesn't?
Yeah, really important question. So I want to be very clear that our infection control recommendations in the healthcare workplace are always more stringent for healthcare workers than they are for the general population. Of course, these healthcare workers are treating immunocompromised patients. They're treating patients who have underlying medical conditions, who are at very high risk of COVID and may very well be severely ill. So in all of our areas of infection control, we are always much more conservative with our healthcare workers than we are with the general population.
Did the shortage of rapid tests that we're seeing play a role in this decision?
No, this decision really from the isolation standpoint had everything to do with the fact that we wouldn't change our guidance based on the result of that rapid test. And you know that it didn't have anything to do with any shortage at all, because we recommend a rapid test for those in quarantine.
Well, on testing, I do think the administration deserves credit this week for saying that, yes, the U.S. is not where they need to be when it comes to testing. I mean, I covered the former administration where the former president said in the CDC of March of 2020 that everyone who wanted a test could get a test. That was not true then. And of course, now people still cannot get rapid tests easily. And so when is everyone going to be able to walk into a drugstore in January specifically and be able to pick up one of those rapid tests?
Right. The government is doing a lot, and we have the need to do more. And I think that was articulated this week. We have a half a billion more rapid tests coming in the month of January. And I think really in the context of this Omicron surge, not just here, but across the world, there is a global shortage of rapid tests.
Okay, a shortage of rapid tests, but even once they are back on shelves, which, you know, Dr. Fauci has said would happen in January, they're still pretty expensive. And I don't think it's been very clear from the administration why they're not free or basically free if you do want people doing as much testing as the administration has recommended.
Right. So we now have 20,000 sites where you can get a PCR on site, and more federal new testing sites coming online in the current moment. The administration is doing a lot to make sure that those rapid tests are affordable and accessible. And I know with this bringing the half a billion rapid tests that are coming in January, there will be free rapid tests at sites so people can easily access them.
Yeah, I think affordable, though, really does depend on your definition of it, because they can be, you know, $25 for a box of two tests. But I do want to ask you before we let you go two quick questions. One, the CDC has revised its estimate of how much Omicron is in the U.S. right now pretty significantly from what the CDC said. So what is the change in this?
Right. Really important question. So what we do is we take the genomic surveillance data that we have and we do predictive modeling in order to assess and estimate the prevalence of Omicron. Of course, early in Omicron, when we have really rapid speed, those predictive estimates can be less stable. And that's what happened in this period of time. So we have revised our estimates. We've done so transparently. But I think the important thing to note here is that there are areas of this country that have 20% Omicron. There are areas of this country that have 90% of cases Omicron. And what we have seen and what our predictions have demonstrated is that this is a rapidly increasing variant in the United States.
It is a rapidly increasing variant. I think that's why sequencing is so important to so many people to know, of course, where it is and how much of it is here. Also, parents are paying very close attention to this rise in pediatric hospitalizations that we've been seeing. Luckily, most of them are not severe cases, but I'm wondering if you have an update for parents on when kids under 16 are going to be able to get a booster shot and when kids under 5 are going to be able to get vaccinated at all.
Right. So the first thing to note is to get your children vaccinated. We have vaccines available between the ages above the age of 5. The FDA is currently looking at the issue of booster shots for those 12 to 15. And I know that the companies and manufacturers are working towards data for children under 5. That will not be in the month ahead, but we're working hard to get there soon.
Do you know the timeline for boosters? Because I think parents have asked, you know, if my child who is of that age of 12 to 15 can get vaccinated, why can't they get a third shot, given the heightened concern that we're seeing right now?
Yeah, absolutely. So the FDA is looking at that right now. Of course, the CDC will swiftly follow as soon as we hear from them. And I'm hoping to have that in the days to weeks ahead.
Okay, so days to weeks ahead potentially for booster shots for those under 16. You said not in the next month for those under 5 for vaccinations overall. Dr. Rochelle Walensky, thank you for joining us this morning on all of this.
Thank you so much for having me, Caitlin.